In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're seated. Will you join me in prayer? Help us, O Lord, to be masters of ourselves, that we may become the servants of others. Take our minds and think through them. Take our lips and speak through them. Take our hearts. Set them on fire for Christ's sake. Ever heard of phlogiston? All right, how about orgone? How about luminiferous ether?
I know her.
Alkahest. And this one you've probably heard of, miasma. Chances are, with the possible exception of that last one, you haven't, and unless you're very quick on your Google search, there's no reason you should have, because they are quite literally nothing. No thing. Or to explain a little more fully, they're the names of substances that were once thought to exist, but have since become discredited. So phlogiston, for example, was coined in 1667 by, anybody, Mueller? Yeah, all right, see? Johann Joachim Becher, a German alchemist, to describe what he believed was the essence of fire, a substance purportedly present in all combustible material and released as flame during combustion. We now know that phlogiston is so much. Orgone was posited in the 1940s by psychoanalyst Wilhelm Reich to describe sexual energy that could be collected for medicinal purposes, if only. And then, of course, just this week, the FDA approved, right, the first prescription drug Adderall designed to boost sexual desire in women, a milestone that's long been sought by the pharmaceutical industry to replicate the blockbuster success of impotence drugs for men, so maybe that one's not so far off. Luminiferous ether comes from a 16th century philosopher and mathematician, René Descartes. To name a supposed medium more subtle than air, he said, through which light and gravity travel. And its existence has since been disproved by, what did we talk about last week? Einstein's theory of general relativity. Finally, alkahest was the name given by a 16th century alchemist, Paracelsus, to what he believed was a universal solvent. It was thought to be an ingredient of the fabled philosopher's stone, for those of you who are Harry Potter fans. It was said to be capable of turning base metals such as lead into gold or silver. Miasma was a word that's familiar. In English, it's come to refer to a noxious atmosphere such as cigarette smoke or maybe incense, a foul smell like that arises from a swamp, or the toxic influence of bad company such as people being filled with hate for others. But its original meaning was a bad smell that spread diseases against which you should shutter the windows at night. It came from the ancient Greeks and has been debunked by the discovery of infectious diseases through bacteria and viruses. Is faith just another discredited substance like those? It's an interesting exercise as we think about Peter's answer to Jesus' question, do you also want to get out of here? You want to go away? Jesus had been talking about his flesh and blood as spiritual food and drink, and it led many of those who'd been hanging around Jesus to say, this is hard. That's a hard teaching to accept. That's pretty difficult to believe, Jesus. And suddenly Jesus is totally incredible. Unbelievable, maybe discredited. He's just Another foolish notion in the minds of those ancient Jews, as much as our gum is for us today. They weren't saying that they didn't get the metaphor. It wasn't that hard to understand that Jesus was using a figure of speech. No, what they were struggling with was Jesus' explicit offer of himself as the source of true and eternal life to those who believe. For many of those who had thought of themselves in Jesus' company, thinking that he was simply a teacher, perhaps the best teacher around, but still just a teacher, some may have been there because Jesus had provided them actual bread. Remember those 5,000 he fed? Or maybe he'd even healed them. But now he was saying something, well, utterly preposterous on its face. Yeah? Believe in him, dine on him, and he will raise them up on the last day. It wasn't so much that this teaching puzzled them, it offended them. You can almost hear them say, who does he think he is? The Holy One of God? And because of this, many of those who've been following him turned back and no longer went about with him. In effect, those who abandoned Jesus that day were classifying Jesus' claims as just so much bunk. A load of hooey. So many deserted Jesus that day that only the 12 were still with him, and apparently he wasn't sure that they were all in this either. And so he asks them, do you want to go away too? And Simon Peter speaks for the group. He says, Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We've come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God, to believe and to know. In the context of what was happening that day, Peter's statement is remarkable. And in fact, he was saying, despite the conclusion of all those others who turned away from you, despite the centuries of synagogue teaching that makes no mention of Eucharistic theology, despite the improbability of any human being embodying the words of eternal life, we believe that you, Jesus, have the words of eternal life and that you are the very Holy One of God. With his answer to Jesus, Peter actually shows us quite a bit about the nature of faith. Clearly, what he's aware of is that Jesus' offer of eternal life has been discounted by the departed crowd, and he surely knows there is no proof to the contrary. But he's saying that based on what he and the other 11 have seen of Jesus, what they've experienced of him, they are choosing to believe. He's showing the truth that believing in Jesus is always a matter of choice. Peter is kin to a great many Christians down through the centuries who've acknowledged to themselves, if not to others, that there are enough reasons not to believe in Jesus if that's what they conclude. But there are also reasons to believe. And they've made the believing choice. Faith, you see, is something that may take time to grow. Often that choice isn't as dispassionately made as we've just described it. Sometimes it's made years after the fervor from an early commitment to follow Jesus has worn off. Sometimes it occurs after some wrenching personal catastrophe. It's called into question everything we think we knew, everything we thought we believed. Sometimes it's forced on us by our own thinking process after some gradual enlightenment. Note that Peter's answer included this: we've come to believe and to know you are the Holy One of God. That's the New Revised Standard Version translation, and it's a pretty accurate translation of the verse. We've been talking about belief, but is Peter saying something different when he claims not just to believe in his heart, but to know with his intellect? The underlying Greek word is used in the New Testament doesn't mean knowledge in the sense of certainty. Rather, it's something like frequently indicates a relation between the person knowing and the object known. In this respect, what's known is of value or importance to the one who knows, and hence the establishment of the relationship between the two. This is part of the Greek worldview that you become one with a thing that you know. You join it, in some sense, in relationship. That's where belief in Jesus is headed, and where it makes the most sense, in a relationship with him. For those who make the distinction, the decision to follow Jesus, there's a different kind of certainty available. Jesus referred to it one time when he was challenged about where his teaching came from. He responded, "My teaching is not mine, but it's the one who sent me." Anyone who resolves to do the will of God will know whether the teaching is from God or whether I'm speaking on my own. In other words, by doing what we perceive as his will, which is what a relationship with Jesus calls us to do, you can get a sense of the reality of Christ. St. Augustine put it this way, believe that you may understand. That kind of understanding is the evidence that Jesus' offer of real and lasting life not belong on the discredited claim heap of history. That's not what we usually mean when we use the word certainty. It's what we might call conviction instead. The theologian Ed Gunger says that the certainty statements, such as Jesus is the answer, make many Christians nervous. Me too. But he says, what if Jesus isn't the answer? What if he's the question? What if we aren't supposed to have all the answers? Could it be that in the discomfort of unanswered questions, we're forced to face our own pride and admit we only know in part? Is it possible that questions cause us to face the choice to believe or not to believe? We live in a culture where a significant and growing, still minority, but not quite, of people see faith as a discredited substance. Maybe you know someone. Maybe you are someone. Where an additional, unmeasured, but certainly sizable number of people live as though it were discredited. Despite what lip service they might give it, living as we do in the midst of that culture of the nuns, the N-O-N-E-S, when asked for, you know, religious preference. Living as we do, it's important to remind ourselves of the testimony of Scripture. That's what we're here for this morning. The writer of Hebrews disputes the discrediting of faith by saying straightforwardly, faith is the substance of things hoped for. The Greek word translated as substance is hypostasis. It's the same word that Hebrews author used to describe the very essence of God that's imprinted in Jesus. He is the reflection of God's glory, the exact imprint of God's very hypostasis, very being. In 2007, after the publication of his book, God Is Not Great, Christopher Hitchens became one of the leading voices in the so-called New Atheism movement. That movement differs from the more unusual disbelief in God in that it is openly antagonistic toward theism. Hitchens is a Brit who had moved to the United States, and he describes himself not just as an atheist, but as an anti-theist. Somewhat less known in America, his brother, Peter Hitchens, is a writer for several British publications. He also journeyed toward atheism for a time. Despite the fact that both brothers were raised in a Christian household, in his book, The Rage Against God, Peter Hitchens says that he, like many others in his generation, was sure certain that our civilization had grown out of, quote, the nursery myths of God and angels and heaven. We had modern medicine and penicillin, jet engines, the welfare state, the United Nations, and science, which explained everything that needed to be explained. He saw faith as a discredited substance. And then when Peter was 30, he began a slow return to faith. When he eventually married in a church, the service had a deep impact on him. Quote, I can recall the way the words of the Church of England's marriage service awakened thoughts in me that I had long suppressed. Peter says, I was entering into my inheritance as a Christian Englishman, as a person, as a human being. It was the first properly grown-up thing I had ever done. The brothers are now going in opposite directions. Quote, while I was making my gradual hesitant way back to the altar rail, my brother Christopher's passion against God grew more virulent and confident, Peter says, as he has become more certain about the non-existence of God, I have become more convinced we cannot know such a thing in the way we know anything. So we must choose whether to believe or not. I think better by far to believe. Well, so too did that other Peter, the one who spoke up for the 12 and declared to Jesus, you have the words of eternal life. It comes down to this. Do you want to know God personally? To follow Christ. If so, there's plenty of evidence to support your decision. But if you don't want that, then there are plenty of ways to deny the testimony of the evidence. But when you choose to believe, your faith becomes its own testimony. It becomes a thing of real substance on which to build your whole life here. And eventually, you carry it into eternity. Far from being discredited by new discoveries, by the sophistication of our age, faith remains a substance of things hoped for.